Today, it's Chinese chips that has Washington concerned, something laid out by Chris Miller of Tufts University in his book, Chip War. We asked him for an update given the billions of dollars in U.S. subsidies about to be announced under the Chips and Science Act.
The boom in investment in artificial intelligence has impacted the chip industry too. And today there's actually a shortage of the types of chips that are used to train AI systems. Even the biggest companies in the world, Microsoft, Amazon, Google, can't get enough of these specialized AI chips. And in part because of this, all of the world's governments, from the US to Japan to Europe to China, are pouring tens of billions of dollars into their own chip industries, trying to make sure they've got that competitive ability to stay up with regard to these chip making capabilities that are needed for AI chips.
At the same time, there have been various actions taken by the U.S. government and others to restrict China's access to some of the machinery, if I can put it that way, the technology to develop these chips. How effective is that, do we know?
Well, I think the honest answer is that it's still pretty early in the process. The restrictions went into place in late 2022, and the goal of the restrictions was not really to stop China in its tracks, but rather to slow its progress over time. And so China's continuing to make progress. SMIC, the leading Chinese chip maker, is moving forward in its technological capabilities. But I think it's already likely the case that it's moving forward at a slower rate than it would have had these controls not been in place. And you know, the key is not really where is China, but it's where is China relative to the most advanced capabilities in Taiwan or in the United States or in South Korea. And there you see that China is making some progress closing the gap, but a really sizable gap remains.
A lot of these chips actually get put into other products that get imported. Do we know where the chips are coming from?
Well, I think that's part of the challenge. You're right to say that the U.S. and Europe and Japan are the same. We don't actually import many chips from China directly. Most of the Chinese chips in our systems are actually first sent to Vietnam, then to the Philippines, then to Malaysia. And some companies don't always know the origins of every single component inside of their system. And that's why a traditional anti-dumping tariff might be less relevant in this case.
It's not just the United States and China, but also I've read now about Japan actually investing in at least the precursors to some of the chip manufacturing. What is the role of Japan potentially in subsidizing some of the more advanced chips?
Well, today Japan doesn't produce any of the most advanced chips domestically, but it plays a major role in producing the machines and also the chemicals that are needed in cutting-edge chip making. And there's some really unique expertise among a handful of Japanese firms, especially in the chemicals sphere, where Japan has very high levels of market share and limited competition because they've been investing in this sphere for now several decades. And that's where the Japanese government is focusing a lot of its efforts and retaining its advantages that it has over other countries in these chemicals.
Historically, there's been some skepticism about industrial planning, really the ability of governments to decide to allocate capital. And we have a number of instances where it's gone really badly, in fact, where there's been misallocation. Is there a risk of that here, and how do we avoid it?
Well, I think it is a risk, and I think there's we're right to be skeptical. I think that the challenge is, what do you do if China is going to subsidize regardless? You know, it's easy to imagine a fantasy world in which no one's subsidizing, but that's just not the world that we live in. And in fact, China started its semiconductor subsidies first. In 2014, Xi called semiconductors a core technology, and China started setting up its first government-backed investment funds to pour money into the chip industry. And so whether you're the US or Japan or Europe, you've got to act with that as a fact. That's just a given. And you've got to devise your policy around that. And I think one of the reasons why the U.S. Congress passed the CHIPS Act was because they realized that there were U.S. firms, U.S.-based firms, that were getting more money in subsidies from foreign governments than from the U.S. government. And so given those circumstances, it wasn't a surprise that U.S. companies were moving manufacturing overseas. And so given the scale of Chinese subsidies, I think a lot of governments are saying, we might not like industrial policy, we might be skeptical of it, but what is the alternative given that China's pouring so much money in?
An important driver behind all this is this move to generative AI and the demand for high-end chips that comes with that. We now hear some of the big, big tech players here in the United States saying they want to basically vertically integrate and produce some of their own chips. Not all of them necessarily, but enough. And we hear from Microsoft and Amazon and Alphabet. What is their capacity? Do you anticipate that they could actually step up to the bar and make a substantial difference?
Well, I think we do already see these companies making a difference. For example, Google has a chip called the TPU, which has been producing for some time, and many of its own AI models are already trained on this chip. Amazon and Microsoft are somewhat less developed, but still have their own chips that you can already use in data centers. And now OpenAI, according to media reports, is considering building out its own network of chip factories. Here's the challenge. AI requires tons and tons of computing power, which means tons and tons of advanced semiconductors. And right now, there are just a couple of companies, NVIDIA, the most important, that can produce these ultra-advanced chips for AI. And so given that, it's not a surprise that whether you're Microsoft or Amazon or Google, you want more competition and more sources of supply for these ultra-critical chips.
Professor, as you look at this race, because it really is a race to move into generative AI and the high-end chips that really will service that, you better than most could tell us, what's the biggest risk? What could go wrong, really wrong, with this process?
I think the key uncertainty right now is how companies will monetize all the investments in AI that they're making right now. There's a ton of excitement, I think justifiably so, in all the different use cases of AI, but the investment dollars going into building out AI infrastructure are really substantial. And in the next couple of years, I think investors are going to be asking, what's the monetization plan behind all of this investment? And we're in the early stages, but I think every technology boom often tends to have bubble aspects to it. And I'm sure there's a chance down the road that some of the investments being made right now end up not being monetizable and therefore end up being wasteful.